the point of murder. I'm in Jerusalem's old city, trying to understand the role deeply held faith plays in the bitter conflict here. One of the first things you notice is the edgy watchfulness. The different ethnic and religious communities live cheek by jowl, but there are security checkpoints throughout the old city, and one section, above all, is under heavy guard. For the Muslims, the compound enclosing the Dome of the Rock and El-Aqsa Mosque is, after Mecca and Medina, the third holiest site in Islam. It was from here, they believe, that the Prophet Muhammad flew up to heaven. As bad luck would have it, the Jews believe the same place is the site of the long-destroyed first and second temples, the holiest shrine in Judaism. Jews are not allowed to worship inside the compound. Their prayers are restricted to the ruined Western or Wailing Wall.
When Jesus came here to overturn the tables, there was no mosque in view. When the Arabs conquered this part of the world, they established the El-Aqsa Mosque, and then they put over where we think is the main temple compound, where the altar was, where the Holy of Holies was. They put another building called the Dome of the Rock, which is not properly a mosque. And we, at the present moment, are simply not allowed in there, inside the compound, identifiably as Jews.
The Muslims reject these Jewish claims. And when Ariel Sharon entered the Temple Mount area in the year 2000,
I came here with a message of peace.
His visit sparked the second, or Al-Aqsa, Intifada, a Palestinian uprising that has cost 4,000 lives so far.
وإذا أراد اليهود السلام مع العرب والمسلمين وفلسطين فليبتعدوا عن المسجد الأقصى المبارك.
And if the Jews sincerely want peace with the Arabs and the Muslims, then they should stand away, keep away from the Al-Aqsa Mosque.
In the Muslim religion, there is no possibility anyway of sharing the territory. If I come in there in some far corner, far away from a mosque, in an open area under a tree somewhere, if a Muslim will catch me murmuring psalms or some other prayer, he will call the police to have me egressed, shall I say.
As far as the Al-Aqsa Mosque is considered, there are no negotiations, absolutely no negotiations about it.
لأنه لا يملك أحد من المسلمين في العالم أن يتفاوض على الأقصى.
Because no Muslim has the right worldwide to negotiate over the Al-Aqsa Mosque.
Again and again, my conversations come back to the solid walls that religion puts up, back to implacable faiths. My holy book is true. I am right. He is wrong. So I went to meet someone who, in my naivety, I thought might be able to see both sides of the story. Yusuf Al-Khattab used to be called Joseph Cohen, born and brought up as a secular Jew in New York. In 1998, he moved to Gaza as a Jewish settler. But there he discovered a different God, Allah.
What I notice coming to this center of world religions, what a lot of hatred religion cost us. I mean, I'm an atheist and I'm rather gentle. I don't hate people, but it seems to me that I'm hearing hate on all sides, and it seems to me all to do with religion.
I hate atheists because atheists don't care if somebody fornicates in the middle of the street. They don't care if they're women go bouncing around on TV topless. It makes no difference to them. They don't believe anything. If you don't believe in a set rule and you believe that a constitution can change and you can amend the rules as they go along and you don't believe in God's rule, then what law do you have? You just have man-made laws.
I realized I was in the company of someone who has willingly bought into fundamentalist dogma.
Religion is the basis of morality. What do you think about the September the 11th attacks on New York and the July the 7th attacks in London?
Okay, since you like to speak about evolution, I like to start before. What do you think about the Jews that have destroyed over 417 Arab villages, including all mosques and masjids, which wouldn't affect you because you're an atheist? So what are you saying, that we should sit back and say, oh, you know what? Let us progress and let us sit down and drink tea and talk about what to do. I think that's the most ridiculous thing. All I could say is, if there was no quote-unquote state of Israel, there would have been no September 11.
But if we've all got to live together, it's not going to be helped if there are people of very, very strong faith who simply know they're right and are not amenable to argument, because there's somebody out there who's just as faithful as you and has his faith just as strong as yours, which is opposite to yours.
You see, the problem is, Richard, I think that you have fear. You know that this party of occupying Muslim lands and polluting society with these evil ideas that are around, it's not going to last forever. There will always be the soldiers of Allah there to give the response to this. So we also want the same thing. All we want is that we want the non-Muslims at this point off the lands of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. All the lands of Muhammad, we want the kufar out of it.
Do you want Islam to take over the rest of the world?
Of course I want it to, and it will. So my advice is to clean up your show at home, take your forces off our lands, correct yourselves, fix your society. All right, fix your women.
Fix your women, that's not my business, that's my women's business.
No, your business. It is your business. When you take the women and dress them like whores on the street.
I don't dress women, they dress themselves.
No, but you allow it as a norm to let the women go on the street dressed like this. What's going on with your society?
But I'm interested in religion and the effect that it has on people's minds, and I'm worried about it.
And we're very worried about you. What's going on with the stealing, with the theft? It's out of control.
Clearly, historic injustice towards the Palestinians breeds hatred and anger. But we must face up to the fact that in creating the death cults of suicide bombers, it's unshakable, unreasonable conviction in your own righteous faith that is the key. If preachers then tell the faithful that paradise after martyrdom is better than existence here in the real world, it's hardly surprising that some crazed followers will actually swallow it, leading to a terrible cycle of vendetta, war, and suffering.
Well, I'm here on the Mount of Olives, looking out over this beautiful old city. We've heard some pretty extreme statements, some hatred, some bigotry, such as I haven't really heard before. I don't see what future the world has as long as people think like that, and people are going to go on thinking like that, as long as they're brought up from childhood, from the cradle, to think that there's something good about faith, to think that there's something good about believing because you've been told to believe, rather than believing because you've looked at the evidence.
I want to say that killing for God is not only hideous murder, it is also utterly ridiculous. Unlike religion, science doesn't pretend to know everything. There are still deep questions about the origins of the universe that have yet to be explained. But just because science can't answer them right now doesn't mean faith, tradition, revelation, or an ancient holy text can. Science can't disprove the existence of God. But that does not mean that God exists. There are a million things we can't disprove. The philosopher Bertrand Russell had an analogy. Imagine there's a china teapot in orbit around the sun. You cannot disprove the existence of the teapot because it's too small to be spotted by our telescopes. Nobody but a lunatic would say, well, I'm prepared to believe in the teapot because I can't disprove it. Maybe we have to be technically and strictly agnostic, But in practice, we are all teapot atheists. But now, suppose that everybody in the society, the teachers, the tribal elders, all had faith in the teapot.
Stories of the teapot have been handed down for generations. It's part of the tradition of the society. There are holy books about the teapot. Then somebody who said they did not believe in the teapot might be regarded as eccentric or even mad.
There's an infinite number of things like celestial teapots that we can't disprove. There are fairies. There are unicorns. Hobgoblins. We can't disprove any of those. But we don't believe in them any more than nowadays we believe in Thor, Amun-Ra, or Aphrodite.
We are all atheists about most of the gods that societies have ever believed in. Some of us just go one god further.
In the next program, how faith acts like a virus that strikes the young, and how the good book, which people follow for moral instruction, actually reveals a god who is surely the most vindictive character in all fiction.
There's more discussion on the issues raised in this program on Channel 4's Can You Believe It website at channel4.com/culture. Down with the youth, or is he? It's Celebrity Big Brother.